Amen, amen. Come on in, come on in. Share. Share this broadcast. I won't be long. Holy Ghost have his way. I won't be long. Amen, amen. Come on and just share this message that God had put in my heart since yesterday evening. And I wanted to just take this time out to come on and do a Facebook Live to just share what thus saith the Lord. Amen. So as you come on in, thank you so much for joining. Thank you. Thank you. And please hit that share button. Invite some friends out. I'll do the same. Just going to invite some people out. Let them know that God has a word for them. Amen. Amen. I won't be before you long. Like I said, this is something that God had laid on my heart to just bring before a select group of people. Amen. So if you're listening to this live, and if you happen to catch this replay in this season, then this word is for you. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Come on, give him some praise. Hallelujah. Come on, give him some praise. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Ayayash. Hey, hallelujah. Sandaria kaya de yanda. Hal, ike no motoya. Isaya lotikia da ista. Itutu shidiaki oko pa. Heat. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Listen, listen. I said I wasn't going to be long, and I mean that. Holy Ghost going to have his way, but I got work to do. I got things to do. I got to do kingdom work, but this has been burning in my spirit since last night, and the fire was lit earlier today, and I just had to come home and do this real quick because, as the picture says, spiritual covering during your season of suddenly blessings. Let me break that down. I've been seeing so much, me included, so many people are in their suddenly season, their sudden blessing season, their season of sudden blessings. Come on, somebody understand me. Somebody is going through it. I'm not the only one. Suddenly the blessings are what? Overtaking us. We minding our own business and all the seeds we planted and all the prayers and fasting that we've been doing. Suddenly it is upon us. The things that we didn't even ask for, they have overtaken us. Spiritual covering. I did a picture. The picture there is an umbrella with rain, rain. Come on, the rain from heaven falling upon us. Amen. Spiritual covering. What am I saying? Holy Spirit said to tell my people this. For you who have, and I'm going to read scripture because I'm going to bring scripture with this message. For you who have what? Let me just bring it. Let me just start out by bringing the scripture. Come on, come on. Have your way, Holy Spirit. John 15. I'll put it in the comments. Don't worry about it. John 15 and 7. You know it. Those of you who heard me talk about it before, you know where I'm coming from. This is King James Version. John 15 and 7. Come on, computer. Don't do this. John 15 and 7 says, if ye abide in me and my words abide in you, ye shall ask what ye will, and it shall be done unto you. That was the scripture that the Holy Spirit put in me to say, remind the people of God, whatever they ask, it shall be done unto them, as long as what? They abide in God, and God abides in them. So if you haven't been walking upright before the Lord, and I got another scripture dealing with that, this message isn't for you. This word of encouragement is not for you. This is for what? Like I said earlier, a select group of people. The Holy Spirit told me to come on here and remind you. This is not me prophesying to you. This is not me speaking a word into you. This is confirmation. This is confirmation, okay, that your suddenly blessings are here. You are walking in your suddenly blessings. I see people being blessed suddenly for things that they prayed for, fasted for, and were believing in God for when everybody else was saying, you're crazy, you done lost your mind. Okay, I'm going to talk about me. I could only talk about me. I done, oh my God, God's got me to the point where I think my head is going to pop off because there's so much going on in my spirit, man. My physical flesh is trying to keep up. I finally had to pop me a vitamin today. Finally had to pop me a vitamin today because I said, Lord, I've been burning the candle on both ends. Lord, you got to make a way where I could just do kingdom 24/7. And I'm suddenly feeling this thing on me like, ooh, I need an umbrella. Ooh, I feel like I'm about to get drenched because suddenly my blessings is coming. And God is not a respecter of persons. That means he's not going to just bless me and don't bless you. That means he's not just going to bless Alicia and don't bless Pam or Ebony or Verna or Tarika. Come on, somebody. We all are what? Walking upright. We all are doing what John 15 and 7 says. We are abiding in God and his word abides in us because now we can ask what we will and it shall be done unto us. Not if, not maybe, not I ain't sure. No, it shall be. There's no rebuking. There's no rebutting. There's no stopping it. It shall be done unto us. Hello, Brother Colin Weber. Thank you so much for your obedience. Thank you so much. I see you, brother. I see you. Come on. I see you, brother. I see you. Come on. Let's just... Come on, everybody. Just clap your hand for Brother Colin Weber. You don't have to understand why. Oh, God. Yes, Lord. Do it, Lord. Yes, Lord. You don't have to understand why. You just be obedient to the Spirit. Amen. So back on track. I got a short time, and everybody laughing at me like, you can't do no short. All right, here we go. John 15 and 7. For you select people who have let your walk be upright before God. You let God abide in you through his word. You abide in God, meaning you walking upright. You studying, you following the laws and the commandments of his word, which is the Bible, okay? He said, everything you ask, he'll give it to you. Why? Because you're no longer asking out of your flesh. You're no longer asking out of your spirit. You're no longer asking out of your sinful nature because you have the Spirit, the Word of God inside you, who has what? Transformed your mind. Your mind is where the transformation must occur in order to feel the what? Former and the latter rain, your suddenly blessings. In this season. Now a season, I'm not talking physical season because we're coming up on, you know, another season in the natural. This season I'm talking about is spiritual. The picture says spiritual covering. I'm not saying y'all suddenly it's going to be November, December, 2020, January, February. That's not what I'm saying. I'm talking about spiritual season. Come on, Jesus, have your way. 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 Why? Why is it not applying to the physical? Somebody want to know? Okay, let me help you. We're dealing with spirit. We got a spiritual God we're dealing with. We're dealing with spiritual things. Okay, you've been fasting. And you've been, look here, to walk upright before God is a physical thing, but it starts in a spiritual place because you got to believe in the unseen thing. Ooh, you got to believe in something you can't see. You got to believe in a God that is spirit. 2 Corinthians 5 and 20:21. Hallelujah. But I'm going to do one better. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Let me go up a verse. Be God, have your way. Have your way. This is all off the cuff. This is not rehearsed. This is all off the cuff. Yo, this is off the cuff. Ain't no notes here. I'm flying on the Spirit. I'm in first class with the Spirit. Here we go. I'm just updating my post. 2 Corinthians 5, 20 and 21. We look in this, in particular, we look in at verse 20, part A. Therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God were making his appeal through us. So you select people who are what? Walking suddenly in your blessings because you did what? Walk upright before God and his spirit abide in you. Okay? Those are the, that's the prerequisite, if you will, to have what you ask for be done in your life. So if you ain't doing that, remember, this ain't for everybody. This word is just for a select few. So if you good with that, if you've been walking upright before God, if you've been following his laws and his ways, and you've been letting his word, which is what? The word of God, the written word of God, saturate your spirit, man. You can ask what you will, and it shall be given unto you. Just as sure as if you wake up tomorrow, you shall see the sunrise. Somebody get that in the spirit. But then 2 Corinthians 5 and 21, 20 and 21 is saying, 20 part 8, therefore we are ambassadors of Christ. I need you to understand who you are. Because sometimes, you know, let me talk about me again. Sometimes we forget who we are. We are ambassadors. Do you know what an ambassador means? An ambassador represents the ambassadors of the United States or your country. They go to what? These meetings, and they represent a nation. We are ambassadors for Christ as though God, look, yeah, we standing in the gap. We standing in the place of God himself in the earth. It says as though God were making his appeal through us. I'm glad y'all can't see me because I'm sure waving my hands and acting a fool in this room. So you got to know who you are so you know what rights you have, so you know how to pose them questions in your prayer time, because some of y'all praying amiss. That's why half who watch it will say, well, I am not experiencing my suddenly blessings. I sure enough don't have no spiritual covering. What's wrong? Why is not happening for me? I'm going to get to that. Let me finish. Verse 21 says, God made him who knew no sin to be sin on our behalf, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Now, I title this, for we are the righteousness of God. That's what I put up here in this video. Y'all, I don't need to tie this all in for you, right? Okay, for the slow folk in the back of the room, I'm going to tie it all in. Jesus. Let me help you. 2 Corinthians 20, part A is saying, therefore, we are ambassadors of Christ. Let me break that down. Therefore, Nakia, Verna, Lanique, Alicia, you are representing the what? Kingdom of God. You are Jesus Christ in the earth. You are representing him in the earth. What did Jesus say? When he go, he going to send another one. He going to send the comforter. Who going to what? Give us. He going to, the comforter, the Holy Spirit that is in us. What? We are now able to do more than Jesus did. He said, you're going to do more than this in my name. You're going to be an ambassador. You representing Christ in the earth. Oh, let me help you. If you tapped into Christ, and through Christ, you are what? Co-heirs, meaning you are also the sons and daughters of God, God our Father, then whatever you ask for, ye shall have. That's why you ain't got your suddenly blessings, because you didn't know who you were and you weren't asking the right questions at the right time. When you was praying and fasting, that was the time to say, Lord, I come to get cleaned up and I come to get refilled. I come to be what? Regenerated, my mind renewed. Oh my God. See, Jesus walked on the earth because he knew who he was, and he would talk to the demons and he would just talk to Satan himself, the tempters, because he knew who he was. Some of y'all probably never read 2 Corinthians 5 and 20. Let me not lie, it's been a while and I don't remember that verse, but the Holy Spirit brought that to me. The Holy Spirit brought me 2 Corinthians 5 and 20 through 2 Corinthians 5 and 21, because I remember that part about the righteousness of God. And in my, you know, checking out, Googling the scripture that it goes with, I came upon verse 20. And the first thing I saw, it said, therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ. as though God were making his appeal through us. Do you really understand what that second part of that sentence is saying? It's as if God is, okay, we got our physical body, we show up in a place, and all of a sudden God take over. Somebody said, Zita, you know, when the Holy Spirit get a hold of you, you can't stop. Well, there it is. Same example. So whatever your situation is, and I got to go, whatever your situation is, whatever it is you're going through and you just can't figure out, Lord, when is my blessing coming? When is my suddenly blessing coming? Did you open your mouth and take authority over that situation? I mean, no, did you really do it? Don't fool me now. You might be able to fool me, but you can't fool you and you can't fool God. Did you really go with understanding? I didn't say you're going before God rude and all arrogant. That's not what I'm saying. But did you go before God knowing who you are? Because God is one who's like, remind me of my word now. Let me see that you got my word in you. Give me back my word. You know, you, anybody here who's a teacher, okay, the teacher want to know you. You studied that subject matter when you went home. So they give you a test. But that's not the only way the teacher gauges if you really understand the material that's taught in the class. Why? Because the teacher will just have random question and answer periods where you ain't looking in the book. Close the book. I don't know if that, so I'm the only one that happened to? I don't think so. Close the book and the teacher just start asking questions. All right, let me break it down to you. When you were a kid, when you were a child, you didn't go to your parents and ask them to use something you know they didn't possess. Let me break it down even further. Went to Walmart last night, took my daughter. We was going to go get some body wash and stuff like that. I'm pushing the trolley, looking like I'm driving Miss Daisy. I'm pushing the trolley. My sister girl got her pocketbook on one arm, her hand, her wrist held out like she $1 million lady. Come on, follow me, somebody. And I'm pushing the trolley behind her. And she just grabbing products off the shelf and putting them in the shopping cart. She ain't checking no prices. She ain't even asking, can she get? Why? Because she understand I am her child and she got me because she got the money to pay for whatever I put in this shopping cart. My daughter walks understanding who she is whenever she goes anywhere with me. That's the kind of attitude I need you to have. Sometimes we got to look at these kids and get the mind of a child sometime. You know, have the faith of a child. If you understand who you are who now? Come on now, this pop quiz, or this open book, I don't gave you the answers. You are what? You are an ambassador for Christ. But most importantly, when you show up in a situation, you are proxy. You are what? You are in place of God himself, because it is as God himself showed up to make the appeal through us. That's what the word of God say right there. As though God himself, as if God, look here, it's like this. If God had a physical body to inhabit, he would have showed up. But he, you know what? He sent us, you and me, filled with his spirit, we the next best thing. So whenever you in a situation and it looks like it ain't going to be your suddenly blessing, but you know you've been praying about this. You know you had dreams and visions and God has shown you, this is what I got for you, daughter. This is what I got for you, son. But oh my God, when you step up in the room, it's hell. Everywhere is just torment, confusion. You just want to rip your hair out. You just want to hurt somebody. Let's be real now. You get so in your feelings. Then a still soft voice be like, wait a minute now. But I done showed you that this was coming. God don't let nothing happen to his own without showing us what's ahead of us. And if you're not getting revelation prior to the crossroads that you face, we all face them, and you need to check how close are you to God? Because God talks to people who are closest to him. Why? Because God, Jesus, thank you for the revelation. A still soft voice cannot talk across the room. You can't hear that across the room. I'm projecting now, so they probably could hear me in the next house across. Yeah, I know they can. My neighbors could hear me right now because I'm talking real loud. But when I get real quiet, Jesus, you got to be real close to me to hear what I'm saying. That's how the Holy Spirit acts. And if you don't have a close relationship with the Holy Spirit, which is the Spirit of God, when he's talking real soft, you will miss it because you're so used to big, loud speech. You're so used to somebody knocking you upside the head to show you attention. You're not used to that sweet voice wrapping you in the tongues of love. So you miss the word of God for your life. When God was showing you the red flag and the billboard sign saying, don't go this way, you turn, exit, don't, big old X with a skull on top. You with your, oof, you got on them foggy glasses of the world with the pride of life and all that, them glasses. You can't see it. You got blinders on like a horse running a race. You can't see nothing when God is showing it to you. So if you in a situation and it came upon you as a surprise, I guarantee you ain't close enough to God as you ought to be. The worst thing you could do when you come off a fast is get relaxed. The worst thing you could do when you come off a fast is believe, okay, I'm good. No, baby girl. No, sister boy. You are in for a fight. Why? Because the covenants that you have already broken during your fast, they are now coming back with legal hands of a spirit. Imagine now, you done went to court, you won the case. Let me break it down for you in the natural. You went to court, you was fasting. You won the case because you went through the fast and you made it. You get to the foot of the courthouse. Woo! Here comes Jackleg Jimmy. Hey, bruh, you want to buy this rope necklace? It's only $5. Thing ain't even gold. You know it's hot, meaning it's stolen. You just left in front of the judge. Case dismissed for some foul stuff you already did. You think nobody looking, but here comes the tempter. To what? Reinitiate covenant. So when you come off a fast, expect the opposition to come. And don't be surprised in what body, what vessel it comes in. But when it comes, you need to know who you are. What? I am an ambassador for Christ. And when I step up, it is as though God is making an appeal through me. I have already done what? I have abided in God. His words abide in me. They are tattooed across my heart, seared on my heart, because I've been in the word while I've been fasting. Anything I ask shall be given unto me. When you're in a situation and you are not suddenly being overtaken by blessings, when you know good and well you should be, check your proximity to God. Because we are the righteousness of God. Why are we the righteousness of God? Because God made him who knew no sin, Jesus, to be sin on our behalf, that so that in him, Jesus, we might become the righteousness of God. This is a walk, people. This is a daily walk. This is not a one time round the track and we done sit down. No, this is until death. Just like you take them wedding vows until death do us part. This is covenant. This is godly covenant. Until death do you part. Absent in the body, what? Present with the Lord. That's scripture. God help me. That's scripture. That's scripture. And I'm going to tell it to you right now. That's 2 Corinthians 5. Yeah. 2 Corinthians 5 and 8. 2 Corinthians 5 and 8 says, we are confident then. What? Wait, hold up. Wait a minute. Let me see. Let me break this English down. Some of y'all, you know, English is not your first language. So I'm going to break 2 Corinthians 5 and 8 down for you. Let's do one better. You know, a lot of people know 2 Corinthians 5 and 7. But I'm going to break down 5, 7 through 8. Jesus, have your way. Have your way, Holy Spirit. Have your way. Have your way. Who watching the clock? I said I wasn't going to be here long. Who watching the clock? Let me see how long I've been on here. 22 minutes. I'm almost done. Jesus. 2 Corinthians 5. 7 through 8 says, for we walk by faith, not by sight. So that already telling you we got what? A spiritual walk. We want a spiritual walk. Spiritual covenant. We're okay. We're talking spiritual things now. Everything I talked about was spiritual. Spiritual. We walk by faith and not by sight. The word of God is telling you where your walk and your battle is in the spiritual realm. Verse 8 says, we are confident. Okay, you can't shake this. I got confidence all day, bro. You can't rock my boat. Okay? I'm like a rock. I'm like a boulder. Forget rock. I'm a boulder because a boulder is huge. You can't move me, right? We are confident then. Why they got then there? Why they got then? Why is then there? We are confident then. Then is saying we are confident then in case or in any event, just in case something else happened to us, you know, it don't matter. I don't care what happened to me because, you know, then I'm going to be, or if that happened to me, I'm going to just be good because I already know I'm going to happen to be the next part of this verse. But I got to stop there because the Holy Spirit say, why is then there? Somebody, you know, a lot of people read over that then and they don't understand why then is there. Let me help you. We are confident no matter what. Come hell or high water. Come persecution. Come being talked about. Come being lied on. Come being robbed. Come being vandalized. Come being molested. Come on, Jesus. Come being raped. Come on, somebody. Come being abused. Come on, somebody. Did I talk about being persecuted yet? Yep. So, being lied on. You know, a lot of lying going on. Come being used. You ever been used? I mean, they use you right up. They ain't leave nothing left. I ain't even got a drop of blood. They used you right up. Come abandonment. Woo! Come neglect. I am still confident then, even though that might happen. And to truth be told, and would prefer to be away from the body. Oh, and at home with the Lord. That's the study Bible version. I know a lot of people under they are used to hearing the King James version. So let me repeat the King James for you. The King James for verse 8 is saying, we are confident, yes, well pleased rather, to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord. We are confident, yes. Yeah, I'm confident. I'm confident, yes, no matter what you do. You know, I'd rather be with God. So I don't care if you're threatening to kill me. Spiritually, physically, hey. Because once I leave this earthen vessel, my soul, my spirit, man, will be what? Immediately, in the twinkling of an eye, I'll be with the Lord. I will be in paradise. What did the thief say? He said, Lord, when you enter into your kingdom, he said, look here, bro, today, not tomorrow, not next week, today you will be with me in paradise. So you're going through, and I'm almost done, you're going through your situation, whatever your situation is. I've been getting messages, and I see some people. Some people are in there suddenly, and I thank God for you guys who are in here suddenly. I see you with your messages. I see you with your praise reports and all that. But there are some people who are going through some stuff. Woo! That fasting they did, and that walking with before God, and that regeneration and retransformation of their mind, reforming of their mind. Oh, you thought you was just going to do that and lay down, and it was going to be, you know, bed of roses, Tootsie Rolls all around? No. Them spirits mad. Them spirits vexed. They upset. They coming for you. Look, I could only tell you what I know. I tell people all the time, don't touch it unless you're ready to fight. Don't come out here pretending like, oh, you know, I'm going to have a form of godliness. And that's being spoken about a lot because it's true. People out here looking and acting like, you know, they with God. And them spirits, You see, the spirits be like, yeah, okay, you ain't no threat. But the minute you decide you're going to put down that false persona that you have, the minute you decide you're going to get right and do what thus said the Lord, the minute you decide to really be sold out for God, oh, it's battle axe time. It's, what's the battle axe? Do you know the battle? Let me type that. I need you to understand what I'm saying. Battle axe. Go look up what a battle axe look like. It ain't no normal axe. It's a big old axe. We ain't fighting with no swords no more. Because the enemy is coming with an axe. He coming to chop, destroy. Okay. What is his purpose? To steal, kill, and destroy. To steal, kill, and destroy. He's got a battle axe. You got a sword. The sword is more stronger than the battle axe. We talking spiritual stuff now. But I want you to, after this, go Google battle axe to see what a battle axe look like in the physical. Now imagine that in the spiritual. But you see, we got a sword, but our sword is just not a regular sword you see in these martial arts movies and whatnot. No, we ain't talking about that. But if you are like one like me who watch a lot of these type of movies, you will understand that a skilled swordsman can kill you before you even get the axe up over your shoulder. Because what? You got to lift that axe up and then swing it to bring momentum. Oh, my God. A skilled swordsman. Any skilled swordsman on this live tonight? One who is skilled, who's a master at swordsmanship. If you don't believe me, I double dog dare you to go on YouTube. They got a lot on Instagram. And watch somebody who is skilled with the samurai sword. A skilled samurai swordsman can cut you to shreds before you even get your gun out the holster, before you even could take one step to them. I have watched them, and I'm not talking to ones in the movies. I'm talking to ones in Japan who practice for real. Man, they got to slow the film down so you can see them make their moves, and then they put it in real time. And I'm like, what? Next thing I know, he done putting the sword back inside its sheath, or the katana back inside its scarab. I think that's what it's called. Go watch a real Japanese samurai, not them ones in the movies, because I'm talking about the real ones. So what? We are swordsmen, right? Because we got what? The sword. We dealing with the spiritual sword. And it's a two-edged sword at that. It ain't just like samurai swords are one-sided. They're one-edged. We got a double-edged sword. We cutting going in and cutting coming out. We cutting coming up and cutting down. Oof. So that's why the enemy is mad. Because before then, you was walking around. You ain't had nothing. You had a knife and a fork because you was just eating whatever the world was giving you. So the enemy wasn't studying you. But then you went and you got yourself some revelation. Somebody done invited you to some live. You done watched some YouTube video. Somebody done dropped the word of knowledge inside of you. I'm talking real knowledge of God. Not this fake knowledge. That's another subject. But anyhow, you got some real revelation of spiritual things. The enemy is like, wait a minute now. This fool done picked up a sword and somebody over there teaching them how to use it. You are now what? A ninja, for lack of better words. In the spirit. So now that you know who you are, and now that you know what authority you have, and you got the tools and you know how to use them, you can walk up in any situation and say, I walk by faith and not by sight. It don't look like it's supposed to look right now, but I got the tools. What is the tools? You got prayer, you got fasting, you got the word of God, you got your sword. You need to speak the word of God over your situation, like I've been telling you. You need to find scriptures for your situation and speak it over there. So when you walk up on that job, oh God, when you walk up on the job, when you're in the parking lot, don't stop when you hit the lobby. Now the people might get a little afraid. Don't do that. When you ride up on the job, before you even get to the job, you're supposed to be praising God when you wake up, like I do. The minute I open my eyes, I'm starting to praise him. Getting dressed, I'm praising him. On the way to work, I'm praising him. Get up in the parking lot, locking up my car, I'm hollering and screaming, and I'm praising him. Because I know the minute I put my foot on that pathway to walk up to that front door, the demons in there, they're going to bow, they're going to tremble. Truth be told, nobody bothers me at work, and I love it. Why? Because I walk up in there fully armored, and I have my sword drawn. I don't have my sword put away, tucked in my belt. No, my sword is drawn. I wake up in a spirit of expectancy every day. Lord, I know you're doing something because you got this fire burning in me. And I said it today. I said, Lord, I got to get up out of here. I got to. I got kingdom work to do and it won't let me sleep. My vacation turned into a workation. I worked some more hours on my vacation until I need a break from the hours I worked on vacation. But I was in love with what I was doing. I was doing kingdom. I drink me some water. Y'all got me hollering. I was doing kingdom. Till today, I'm doing kingdom. When I get over here, I got to do kingdom. What am I saying? When you doing kingdom, it consumes you. Because our God is an all-consuming fire. His spirit lives in us. So it what? It's burning up everything that is flesh in us, around us, in front of us, behind us, on the sides of us. Mind is renewed. I'm no longer thinking about the world stuff. I'm thinking about what I could get done for the kingdom. Because I got to tell everybody about this man called Jesus who saved a wretch like me. I was on my way to certain hell. Not maybe. Nah, I had one-way ticket, first class. I don't know about you. I'm going to talk about me. I'm not talking about nobody else on here. So you all right. Your secret is safe. I'm talking about me. I had a one-way ticket, first class. Forget first class. I was co-pilot with the pilot. One-way ticket, first class. Co-pilot going to hell. And somebody told me about a man named Jesus. Let me tell you something. Your story, no matter what it is, can save one soul. And if it just saves one soul, that's worth your lifetime. I don't know what you got inside of you that needs to be birthed. For those of you who do know what it is, press, get it done. No excuses. I am one who doesn't take well to people who always got an excuse. I hurt your feelings and let you know that I'm not the one you need to talk to. Because when you're full of excuses, let me just be honest, I tune you out with one ear. Why? Because I have never allowed excuses to be my reason for not doing anything. Remember what I said, if you give your word, keep it. Otherwise, keep your mouth shut and don't give your word. I gave my word so much that I said to myself, you will learn to keep your mouth shut. That's what you're gonna do. And I've learned since then to be mindful of what and who I give my word to. What am I saying? God has planted seeds in all of us. We all have a gift. We all have kingdom work to do. Your kingdom work don't have to be mine. But we all have kingdom work to do, whatever it is. And if you don't know, ask God to show you. He'll show you again. And then you will scratch your head and be like, you know what? I remember when I was young, I had a passion to do this. God was talking to you then. When you were clean slate, he was able to talk to you better when you were a child. But the traumas and cares of life came and muddied the water. And now we grow old and we wonder. And then somebody lights a spark in us and reminds us. And the Holy Spirit said, remember? You say, yeah, I remember. I used to like to do that. Yeah, that's my calling. And when you start getting busy in your calling, it consumes you. It makes you feel alive. Okay, to the point where you just got to be doing that. And as you get older, you just want to do that. And you trying to figure out, Lord, how can I just do that? That takes what? Walking by faith and not by sight. I'm preaching to me right now because the things God is telling me to get done and do it, I'm like, Lord, all right now. Sink or swim, Lord. Sink or swim. And I know you're not going to let me sink because I was good just sitting over there on the sidelines doing nothing or doing my little thing and then calling it that. But God has placed in us seeds to feed nations. Come on, people. If you connected to me, you ain't feeding just the local. You feeding nations because I have fed nations. We still talking spiritual. Don't think I'm cooking all that food for people. No, we talking spiritual stuff here. I have seen revelation that my fruit has reached worldwide, has reached nations. People I didn't even think knew who, well, they don't know me, but knew my name through my work, through the kingdom things I do. They know me. And I'm like, what? Little old me, who want to be in the back of the room, don't care if nobody know my name, know what I look like. That's me sitting up under the table trying to hide from folk. and other people looking for me with a flashlight. Now you come up front, sister girl. No, I just rather sit in the back. No. God said he will what? Make you the head, not the tail. He will put you before great men. You're going to be what? Sitting at the table. He said, come up to the front. Come up to the front. Yeah, you come up to the front. You trying to hide? That's the favor of God all over you. You walk into a place and people no longer see you as you were, but see you as you are. Let me say that again. You walk into a place with familiars, with people who know you, and they no longer see you who you used to be. They see you as who you are. Yeah, that English might not be right, but you understood what I just said. They see you as you are. They see you what? Remember, you are an ambassador for Christ, as though God himself showed up. They see you who, they see you the way what? They see you the way God sees you, the way God has always seen you, the way the spirits see you now. The way the spirits saw you then. That's why they came to kill that light when it was young inside you, when it was just a little kindle burning. They didn't want no logs to get on the fire to cause a roaring flame. No, they squashed that real early in your life. They set some trap for you. They set some trap, a covenant for you. Whether you knew about it or not, it was set because they saw your potential. They understood the plan of God for your life. They figured if I could just get them early. That's why, that's why the world is after the kids. The world is after the children. Get them while they're young. And just la, la, la the adults asleep. Don't be la, la, la and asleep if you got kids. If you have children, you don't need to be asleep. You need to be on the wall. Amen? And if you got grown children and, okay, you done slipped up and messed up and they done gone their way, think about your life. I went to the left too. I didn't go too far left, but I went far enough. But I already knew I had what? A praying mother. I had a praying grandmother. I had a praying grandfather. I saw prayer in my family. So what can you do if you got older kids? I'm talking to the people now who have older children and your children still out there in the world and you wondering, Lord, when they coming home? Lord, I'm living as an example. Do what I do. I talk to mine all the time. I told her last night. I said, you see me, I'm a living example of what you need to be as a young lady. And I keep saying, whenever you're ready, we're going to throw down like Elijah and the 300 priests. Just put up some altars. I tell you what, you go build the altars yourself. I don't want you to think I contaminated them. And whenever you're ready, we're going to see whose God is God. Hey, God. But I let the child know that I love you no matter where in the world you go. You are mine and I will always love you. No matter where you find yourself in life, I will always love you. Why? Because we need to love them with the love of Christ. We are still but filthy rags, even the righteous of us. So don't be turning away. I don't know who I'm talking to. Don't be turning your children away for no church members. Woo! Jesus, where'd that come from? Woo! For no family members who are talking about your kids. Don't be turning your children away. You love them unconditionally because God loves us unconditionally. You are the closest thing that they see to God. You are to live a life that reflects the love of God. Because the young people of today, they see through hypocrisy like it's a glass. Not even a mirror, like it's glass. They see through hypocrisy. Don't be no hypocrite. Walk the walk. You talking that you on Facebook and you on social media. Walk that life in front of your children. Your children should be able to say, yeah, my mama, my daddy, boy, they love them. Love Jesus now. Yeah, they walking it. They talking it and they walking it. That's the only way you're going to win them. That is the only way you're going to win them. You got to walk the life you talking. And you got to what? Walk by faith and not by sight. And remember, you too was in a situation where somebody had to pray for you. But we have to trust and believe that we live in God because we follow in his word and we trust in everything his word says and we've got the word in us and we know he's our Abba Father and he would love, look here, if you love, the word say, how much more would God love us than a man love his natural son? I mean, I love my child to death, but God love us more than that. So we got to have faith to say, God, if you save me, you'll save my seed. If you save me, you will save my seed. Who am I talking to? Who's where the parents at? Okay, maybe they're gonna show up and listen to the replay. You got to keep praying for your children. You got to keep covering them in the blood of Jesus, praying on the whole armor of God over them, calling down heavenly fire to encamp around them every day, twice a day. I told you, when you wake up and before you go to bed, you start your day where? In the presence of God. You ain't got to spend 35, 45 minutes, an hour. I'm talking to him while I'm getting ready because he already know me. He's like, I know my child's either. She's going to stay in that bed till the last possible minute. She's going to hit the snooze button on that alarm till she can't hit it no more. She's going to jump up, start talking to me while she's jumping in the shower. I'm keeping it real. That's how I roll. God already know. He knows that's me. I know I got her full attention while she's driving in that car because she all about me. She praising me. She talking to me. That's my time with her. I already understand. Okay, if I wake up in the midnight hour, she'll get up. But she ain't that 2, 3, 4 o'clock in the morning tapping on the shoulder. She ain't that prayer warrior. But when she do wake up, it's on fire. It's on and popping. And she sleep hard enough. But when she hear a disturbance in the spirit, I pitch up out that bed like somebody went bang-a-lang-a-lang. Why? Because my spirit man is sensitive to the sounds. Why? Because I spend so much time with God. I can hear the slightest disturbance in the air. That's where I want everybody who connected to me be at. Because I pray for everybody that's connected to me. Let me just make that clear. Everybody who follows me, you are connected to me. How are you connected to me? Because you're following me. I'm leading you down a path. And if you ain't connected to me, then you ain't following me. And I'm not praying for you. But I pray for everybody that is connected to me. Because you got enough faith to say, I'm following this lady because she's talking and I can hear what she's talking and her speech is not her own. It's the voice of God. I just talked about that in 2 Corinthians. You know, because when she show up, God show up through her. I said I had stuff to do. You think I'm on here just for me? Notice I don't have my picture up there. I'm not that narcissist person. And disclaimer, if you like to put yourself with the video, kudos to you. That's just not me. That's never been my personality. I'll be in the back of the room, behind the stage, behind the curtain all day long. I'm good with that. I digress. Let me get back. Pray for your children. Pray for those who are connected to you as I pray for those who are connected to me. Pray for them morning and night. Because when you wake up, you're dealing with the physical and the spiritual. And when you go to sleep, you're whole 100% dealing with the spiritual things. When you wake up and you know you had a dream, what you supposed to do? I done said it a million times. It's in the back of my book. I done put the prayer up several times, but let me help break it down. Father, I know I had a dream. I can't remember. Help me, Lord, to remember the important things in the dream that you would have me to know. Father, I come against any covenant in my dream that was not made with you. And I come into agreement with any covenant in my dream that was made with you. I pray on the full armor of God over me and all those connected with me. I pray the blood of Jesus over me and all those connected with me, our property and our possessions. I pray down a fiery hedge of protection from heaven around us. Something less than. Notice I didn't go off saying no thou art. And using the Queen English and all that. You got to be proper. Listen, you ain't faking it with God. Let me say that again. Don't go faking it with God. God knows when it's me and him talking, it's me and him talking. I'm not looking up scripture when I'm talking to God. Now, when I'm doing spiritual warfare, I'm finding scripture to pray. When I'm talking to God, I'm talking to him like I'm talking to you. He talks to me. I'm talking to him like I'm talking to you. Let me help you. How you gonna go to your mother faking it? Your mother know you better than most people. Huh? She raised you. For those of you who are raised by your mother, whoever raised you, how you gonna go to them fronting? How you gonna go to them faking it? God knows all. How am I gonna go to him saying, oh God, and doing all that pomp and pomp? Even like, see, what's wrong with you? You don't ever come to me that way. I'm gonna say this and I'm gonna go. I don't know why the Holy Spirit got me talking all my business, but here it goes. So lately, you know, I've been seeing all these people with all their beat face. For those of you who don't know what beat face means, they got on all this contour makeup and they looking all this and that. And they do their videos and they dress up. And I got clothes in my closet, but hey, I dress for comfort, whatever. And, you know, I was like, well, maybe I should, you know, put my makeup on. And yeah, I went to school. I have a cosmetology license, so I know how to do the makeup and all that. And I was like, yeah, maybe I should do that and do some lives and try to look cute and all that. Holy Spirit say, who are you trying to fool? That's not you. Why are you trying to be like that? Who am I talking to? Holy Spirit knows who I am. He's like, Zita, that's not you. Why are you trying to be like that? Then he reminds me of someone who said, you don't need to be like that. You are beautiful just the way you are. So I'm saying to whoever needs to hear this tonight, you are beautiful just the way you are. I have a sister. We do not look alike, meaning we don't act alike. She's got to make up videos and stuff that she posts. And I look at them and I'm like, well, I should do that. My daughter, she learned how to do it too. And I'm like, yeah, maybe I should. Holy Spirit's like, why are you faking it? Why are you trying to all of a sudden be who you are not? What am I saying? Don't be going to God acting like you're not. Don't be faking it in front of God. Don't try to pray like somebody else when that's not your prayer style. Don't be trying to dress and look like somebody else when that's not how you look. I have clothes and I will get dressed when the occasion calls for it. Not when my husband comes, but I am. Watch out now. But I need a man to see me beyond the outer trappings. Because see, you got to see me as a spiritual person first. Because these outer trappings are just trappings. Woo! Holy Spirit's having his way. Trappings. See, yeah. You get dressed up and you can look fine and all that. But I know what I look like when I wake up in the morning. And I know what I look like when I'm going out in the morning to go to work. Oftentimes, they're two different people. Come on, can we be real here? Hair one way. Hair everywhere, I should say. Hair everywhere. Looking like, woo, put my finger in the socket. If I don't braid down my hair, my curls are just everywhere. Had acne marks all my life. I'm like, Lord, at my age, I'm still dealing with acne scars and marks and stuff. Hormonal breakouts. One day my skin's clear. Next minute I got breakouts. All I ever wanted was to be able to just put a little face powder and lipstick and a little eyeliner and keep it moving. Instead of wearing, I just wear a little foundation, whatnot, just to even out my yellow skin tone. And for those of y'all, yeah, light skin ain't no better because we show, ugh, Jesus. Light skin folks can show them marks just as, oh, it's worse. You just pinch us and we bruise up. Come on, somebody. So be good, what? Be comfortable in the skin you're in. Love the skin you're in. I love my skin. Oh, you can't say nothing about me. I love me some me. You need to love you some you. Because God loves you the way you are. Who am I talking to? Holy Spirit? Love yourself the way God made you. Don't try to be nobody else but you. Because when you walk into your suddenly blessings, and I'm closing. When you walk into your suddenly blessings, God wants the people to see you, not a carbon copy of your sister, your cousin, some celebrity on TV, some Instagram famous influencer, somebody on YouTube showing you how to do your hair and do your makeup in 10 steps. Y'all got all that time in the morning to do all of that? I barely get out of bed just in time to take a shower, throw on some clothes, and keep it moving. I'm looking for something I don't even have to iron in the morning. Can I keep it real? If it don't have no iron required, that's what I'm wearing that day. I'm trying to get in that bed and stay there as long as I can. Why? Because when I am awake, I am working and I'm working. So when I finally get to sleep, I'm out. I ain't getting up no hour and a half early just to put on some makeup. Who am I talking to? God is telling you, you're wasting your time with all these outward trappings, trying to trap. Trying to what? Falsify. Come on, Holy Spirit. Trying to falsify what you really are. Trying to get something using illegitimate means. Come as you are. Let the people see what you look like on the inside and the outside. Wherever it's hitting you, let it hit you. If you got a problem with your inside, then you need to clean that up. If you're spending too much time on the outside, then you need to find you something that you could deal with. Find you a routine that'll satisfy you. Better yet, renew your mind. Ask God to let you see yourself the way he sees you. Come on, somebody. All that time you're spending on trappings and trying to be like something that you are not, God is saying you could take that time to work on what's more important. Your spiritual life, your life and your time with God, your kingdom purpose. That's what you need to be spending more time in. Getting yourself in a position to be suddenly blessed. You ain't suddenly blessed because you ain't in a position to be suddenly blessed. Because what? Your focus is on stuff that's irrelevant. Stuff and people and situations. Oh, there you go. I'm really going. I knew he was going to do it. Situationships. You know, that's a word. That's a word that used to float around a lot. I don't know if it's floating around a lot now. It might not be floating around a lot, but there are people in situationships. They ain't in no relationship, and they sure ain't in covenant. They in situationships. They got themselves in a situation, okay? Because they out of order, got themselves in a situation. And then you got the ones who got nerve to pray and ask God to fix their situation so it can become covenant. That's funny. I know God just be up in heaven. You know when you palm slap your face? I know God just be sitting on the throne slapping his face with his hand, just like, oh God, here we go again. They got themselves in a situation and now they want to pray and ask me. Oh my God, Beverly. Okay. All right, Beverly, I see it. If you're listening to this, I see what you did. I'll make sure she gets it. They in a situation asking God to, you got the expression, people say, bless this mess. Who's in a situation here tonight? Who's in a situation here tonight? Now, you know you in a situation because I done mashed your toes real hard just now, and you felt that. If you're in a situation and you asking God to bless that mess, come on. God is not going to do it, and that's why you are not in your suddenly blessed season. Yeah, you've been on the fast. You've been praying. Your knees all scraped up because you're on the ground. They scraped up because you're on your knees praying day and night. And God is like, I am not blessing that. I'm talking about where I had to come out of. I was in some situation ships with an S, some situation ships, plural. And every time the Holy Spirit would just say to me, Zita, this ain't going to work. You are not going to get your blessing as long as you're in this situation. You need to just get up, get on, and get out. I was not walking in the will of God. I was not obeying John 15 and 7. I was doing my own thing. I did not understand 2 Corinthians 5, 20 through 21. I sure enough could not profess 2 Corinthians 5 and 8. Because if I had died, I'd be told. I don't know where I was going to end up. Because I wasn't walking up right before God. Bound up or covenant up in covenant that I formed myself. Okay, all right, I'm done. Somebody gonna hear this later. They ain't hearing it now, but they gonna get blessed later. They gonna understand. I just gave you some keys to your release. I just gave you keys to get out of the physical and spiritual prison that you are now in. I just gave you some keys, I said, to be free. I just gave you some keys to experience your suddenly blessing. But for those of you who are what? Spiritually covered right now. The rain is pouring on you. God bless you. The rain is pouring on you. God bless you. Take some of that rain now and go pour and water somebody else. People are watching you. If you are now in your suddenly blessing, all of a sudden stuff just coming up in your life. You are being blessed left, right, and center. And look, blessings don't have to be the big stuff. You know what I find a blessing? I go to the store and buy me some grocery, and whatever that thing say at the end of the day when she finished ringing up, I could just say, here you go, and pay for it. That's a blessing. Blessing don't have to be the big stuff. It's the small things. You woke up this morning with your right mind. Your body is functioning. Okay? You got extra money in the pocket. You could, you know, buy somebody else some lunch. That's a blessing. You are a lender, not a borrower. That's a blessing. You get up on here and watch this internet. That's a blessing. People ain't got no internet. They ain't got no service. You got a phone or a laptop. You listening to this word. That's a blessing. But what I'm really talking about is them suddenly blessings. Them blessings that you just knock you off your feet. You see that umbrella there? That umbrella is that's some real rain dropping. That's not no little drizzle. You don't take out an umbrella when it's just spraying, like they say in the Bahamas, meaning it's just drizzling. You take out an umbrella when there's a downpour. For those of you who are what? Experiencing your downpour, God bless you. Now there's enough room under that umbrella for someone else too. So what are you supposed to do? You're supposed to go pour into somebody else's life, because I guarantee you, you didn't just get your suddenly blessing on your own. Somebody poured into you. Amen. DeAndrea, I'm so blessed that she had a stranger pay for her items in a store. God bless them. God bless them. Amen. So when you are able, DeAndrea, you pay it forward. You do it and bless somebody else. And suddenly blessings. Don't forget somebody else. Because somebody poured into you so you can be blessed. Now be a blessing to someone else so that they can say, wow. And when they say thank you, I know it's cliche, say, don't thank me, thank Jesus. It's cliche, but it's the truth. When they say thank you, don't thank me, thank Jesus. Because if it wasn't for Jesus, I wasn't going to do that. My flesh sure ain't going to do that. Everything I do is because of Jesus. Because flesh don't want to do nothing good. Amen. Be blessed. I'm about to go do some work. Thank you for stopping by. Please share this video with somebody. Be a blessing to them. Share this video with somebody. Be a blessing to them. Somebody needs to understand that all they're going through is not in vain, because there are other people out there who are being blessed of God. Because some people, you know, they want to give up. You know, they, you see, a lot of people, especially new babes in Christ, they come into this Christian faith and they think it's like the world. I just got to do a couple rounds. I just got to box a few matches. I just got to run around the track a few times. I got to give some seed offering, and all of a sudden they get their blessings. It don't work like that. But see, they don't understand that. So it's our job to tell them, look, all of that is fine and dandy, but you got to get to the foundation of this Christianity. You got to get to the foundation of this spiritual walk. And you got to build a strong, firm foundation in Christ so he can build. Ooh, he can build upon it like a house. Jesus. Because what? You build a house what? From the roof down? I think not. You build a house from the foundation up. And before you can even lay a foundation, what do you have to do? Okay, everybody don't know how to build a house. Before they can lay the foundation for the house, they got to what? They got to dig the ground. They got to level the ground. They can't put the foundation if the ground ain't level. So they got to dig up the earth. If there's stones and whatnot in the way, they got to level that all out. They got to dig it all up, move the rocks out of the earth, make it flat, make it level. Then they got to what? Mark out the spot where they're going to lay the foundation, where they're going to pour the concrete or what? Yeah, okay. Put the rebar. Come on. Rebar to what? Reinforce the concrete. Oh, God. Go watch how they build houses. Go watch how they lay a foundation. Don't watch nothing else. Go on YouTube and watch how they lay a foundation for a house. That is the same spiritual thing that happens to a new convert in Christ. Someone who just came to Christ. God, the Spirit, got to do all that to them before he could start laying the foundation and then building up the walls, the windows, doors, and then putting on the roof. That's a process. What happens in the natural and the spiritual? They are mirror. They mirror each other. Amen. So if you're new in Christ and you're like, well, how come everybody in their season and I've been doing this thing now for a couple of weeks and I ain't seeing nothing? I beg to differ. You are changed. There are things going on in your life that weren't going on before. But God has to what? clear the path. He has to dig up the soil. He has to be able to lay the foundation before he can really bless you. And furthermore, if you just became a babe in Christ, are you really ready to do spiritual warfare? I don't think so. Because when you're doing spiritual warfare, you can't get scared and go run and hide and go back into the world and kill. Okay, Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit saying when you're doing spiritual warfare, you can't use what? The world's methods to do spiritual warfare. How are you going to fight the enemy with the enemy? Ooh, somebody. Jesus. Ooh. Okay. How are you going to do that? Because all you knew was the world's way. You need to be what? Retrained, reprogrammed. Like the old people say, you need to go sit down somewhere and be taught. So for those of you who's like, well, I've been doing all of this and I've been, how long you been doing it? Now be real, now be honest. Remember I talked about being real, being honest with God. How long you been doing it? No, how long you been really doing it? Don't tell me you've been doing this for 20 years. You was faking it for 20 years. You was faking Christian, yeah. You was a faking Christian. You was faking the funk, like they say. You was pretending. You sounded like you was playing the horn, but you really was playing the flute. You were not. Come on. You was in the church, going to church every week for 20 years, but were you in the body of Christ? Were you sold out? Were you fasting and praying? Did you get true deliverance? I'm talking about you. Did you get cleaned up? Okay. Because if you have really been cleaned up by God, if you have really been delivered, if you have really broken all those covenants out of your life, you cannot sit here, type on this screen, ain't nothing been changed in your life. You ain't been blessed because you a liar and the truth ain't in you. Why? Because I could talk it because I know it because I walk it. Woo! I'm telling you what I know. I'm talking about me. I always talk about me. If I'm saying something about me and it, you know, causes you offense, to God be the glory. Because you needed some offense in your life. You need someone to knock down those fences in your life. Come on, Holy Spirit, I got to go. Oof. This is the Keep It Real channel. That's what I should name this. The Keep It Real channel. We're going to keep it real. You want some fake deliverance, go somewhere else. There's plenty other places that will pacify you and tell you, you know, say two mantras and donate $50 to me and you'll be free. Woo! Let me know how that work out for you. You'll be in more bondage. One, because you're associating with a liar. The spirit of deception is definitely working in them. And divination, sure enough, because they're giving you false, they prophelying, like they're saying. They're using divination, telling you what the spirit know you want to hear. Then you sowing seeds into their ground, which is rocky. So now you come into covenant with them. Then you wonder why your life went from bad to worse. Oof. You had a moment of reprieve. You see, that moment of look like blessing was just you know, fake gold. It looked like gold, but it really ain't gold. You put that in some chemicals and that thing will turn black in a minute. That's what happened to you. And then all of a sudden you left with this tarnished junk that's not even real gold. And you wondering why you in worse bondage. I've seen people talk about that. Because you done hooked up with what you think deliverance should look like. Listen, and I'm gone. If Christ himself was crucified, persecuted, talked about, okay, while he walked on this earth, what you think they're going to do with us? Real deliverance comes at a cost. And for those of you, and I'll say it every time, who say, you know, the gift of God, deliverance was free. No, it was not. It was not free. Jesus paid a price. You go get beat and whipped like they whipped him. You go get a pier with the head of a spear. You tell me how that feels. You go get a crown of thorns pressed, not just placed on your head, but pressed into your skull. You go pray until you what? You praying so much you sweating blood. Let me know how that worked out for you. That was free? Was that free? I got a better one for you. You go do a 6-hour fast. All right. You go do a fast for 1 hour. Just water. Tell me how you feel about that. Just go fast for 1 hour, water only. You could, let me help you, for you geniuses who will be like, well, I just eat a lot of food before I start fasting and I won't feel nothing. Let me tell you something. Before I got here to do this, a sleep won't fall on me. Let me stop talking, Amen, so you can understand me. The spirit slothfulness came upon me, I would just wanted to go to sleep. Anytime you get ready to do some spiritual warfare, the enemy's going to come against you. You could eat your fridge empty before you do that 1 hour fast challenge that I gave you. And the enemy will come at you while you're on that fast like you ain't ate for days. Hunger will come upon you like you about to lose your mind. Anytime you're getting ready to do real spiritual warfare, the enemy comes and he does what? He fights that flesh. Because when we fast, we what? We crucify in the flesh. And the flesh is how he gets us. So, if you're not walking in your suddenly blessing, go check yourself. Check your proximity to Jesus Christ. Because God always will tell you a warning. He will always tell you the warning. He will always show you the blessings. He will always tell us what's coming. He don't just let us go down the road willy-nilly and don't know what to expect. And if you saying God ain't telling me nothing, he ain't showed me nothing, well, you ain't close to God then. Because God talks to his own. God shows his own. God covers his own. Whose are you? Who's your allegiance to? My allegiance is to God. And He talks to me. He shows me. Every day he's showing me stuff. Every day I feel the power of his love. I feel the power of his anointing. I feel the spirit of discernment just quickening me. Spirit of revelation just knocked me off my chair. Every day, all day. If he's doing it for me and I'm nobody, why isn't he doing it for you? Oh, I know why. I live and eat and breathe in him. And that's just not something fancy I'm saying. I'm telling you the truth. Because I know I can't do nothing without him. Case in point, went to Walmart last night. It's nighttime. I wait till, you know, everybody was out the store so I can hurry get in and get out. But there were still cars parked in the parking lot. And I'm like, okay, Lord, I need a spot. Bam! Here come one guy reversing right in the front of the store. I'm like, thank you, Jesus. My daughter looking at me like, what? It's just a parking spot. I'm like, girl, you don't understand. Thank you, Jesus. Because I need that parking spot, Lord. I don't want to walk in the dark way at the back of the parking lot with my grocery. He gave me the spot right in front of the store. And no, there's no coincidence in Christ. Even the people in the world understand that there's no coincidence. Because they don't believe in coincidence in the world. They believe that everything is orchestrated by their what? Will. They just will it into being. So there's no such thing as coincidence. There's no such thing that that person just happened to be. No. Because if the red light had kept me 2 minutes longer, I wouldn't have got that spot. Come on, somebody. That was divine connection. That was a divine appointment, me in that parking spot. So if God can give me a parking spot, you think he can't give me the things that I petitioned before him because I'm living the life of John 15 and 7? I'm talking to me right now. I came on here to preach to myself. So thanks for joining me, preach to myself. If you are not living the life of John 15 and 7, I urge you, I plead with you to do so. So that you can do what? Experience your spiritual covering to walk in your suddenly blessings. John 15 and 7 is talking about your spiritual covering. If you didn't get that, now you got it. John 15 and 7 is talking about this umbrella, your spiritual covering. Right? And part B is talking about the suddenly blessing. Go study that for yourself. John 15 and 7. Ask the Holy Spirit to break that down even further in your spirit. If I didn't do a good job for you, ask the Holy Spirit to help you with 2 Corinthians 5, 20 and 21. 2 Corinthians 5 and 8. Those are three scriptures I put in the post, in the comments. Go back, scroll up, check them out, or just go look in your Bible. That's what you should do. Open your Bible. If you got a paper Bible, open it. Don't look on the computer. I want you to open your one, the one you could hold in your hand, and look at them words and see if I was lying on here tonight. And say, Lord, break that down to me one more time. I heard the woman of God, but break that down one more time. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. I'm praying, you know, Father God, let me just pray. Father God, I pray tonight that everybody represented here on this live, everybody that will listen to the replay, Father God, I ask that you would impart in them a renewal of the spirit of discernment. I mean, pour into them until it's oozing out of every pore so they could discern everything around them, everything that has purpose in their lives, everybody that you have them connected to. Let them see the purpose for every divine connection in their life, Father God. I pray, Lord God, that you would grant them the ability to interpret their dreams, to get revelation from the things, the secrets that you're showing them in the nighttime, Lord God, and for the wakened visions as they walk throughout the day, the things you're showing them while they're awake, Father God. Give them revelation, Lord God, to understand what you're saying to them. Some of us, Lord God, we need reassurance because we still live in a flesh suit and our flesh get weak and sometimes we forget. Father God, help us to remember your promises, even the ones that you promised years ago that we may have forgotten, that may be covered up by the cares of life and be tucked away in the back of our mind. Lord God, bring it to the forefront with your Holy Spirit to remind us of the things that you have promised over our lives that you said shall come to pass. Father God, I say a special prayer for the children of everybody represented here. Everybody who has a child, Lord God, that does not know you as their Lord and Savior. Jesus, I ask that you would just make yourself known to them in such a way that they cannot deny that you are who you are, that they cannot deny that you are King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Father God, let your Holy Spirit visit them right now, wherever they are. Let them have a supernatural encounter that they cannot dismiss, they cannot deny, they cannot just shake away with their head or flick their wrist and say, ah, it was just a fluke. It was just some coincidence. Father God, I ask you to visit every household. Visit every household, Father God, with your firing angels or swords of fire held high on guard. Protect them, Father God, from the attacks of the enemy that shall come. Because they stand upright before you. But Father God, we know we have no need to fear because you will always be around to what? Be our spiritual cover, to cover and protect us. You give your angels charge over us, Father God. We stand knowing that we are protected because we are co-heirs with Christ Jesus. And being co-heirs with Christ Jesus, Lord, we can ask whatever we will of you and you shall make it come to pass. Because we stand in faith, trusting and believing that you care for us even more than the birds of the air, the fish of the sea, the wildlife upon the earth. We are precious in your sight, so precious that you gave your only son to die a death that we were deserving of. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for sacrificing yourself for us, for taking on the sin that we should have taken on. You took it on for us. Thank you for sharing your rightful place in heaven with us. Thank you for just, oh God, thank you, Jesus, for loving us so much. That you would come to this wretched place, take on this sinful flesh, walk amongst us so that we can be saved, so that we can have access, so that we can have the right to eternal life. I thank you, God, for just loving us, to always cover us the way you cover us. We don't even understand sometimes the things that you protect us from. We just go about our lives thinking God's got us, and we don't give it another thought. But God, I just want to say on behalf of everybody, thank you so much for covering us even when we are not aware, even when we're not saying thank you, Father. Thank you for loving us so much when we rude and we don't even say good night, good morning, good afternoon. We don't even ask you, Father God, how you doing? Woo! We so care about all of our needs. We don't even ask you, Lord, what can I do for you? Use me, Lord. We don't even say, Lord, make a way. Lord, I'll make myself available to be used of you, Lord. You know, help us, Lord God, to be willing vessels to be used by you. Remind us of all your goodness so that we be saying, Lord, you know what? I got nothing without you. Everything I own is yours. I don't even know why I'm trying to front and pretend like I did all of this. Lord God, make it, do with me as you will, Father God. Because I am nothing without you. Remind us, Lord God, that we are nothing without you. Even on our best day, we are nothing without you. As smart as we may think we are not even as close as what we could be if we just be used by you, if we just allow ourselves to be vessels used by you, God, Jesus. Ooh, the little bit of knowledge we think we got is nothing compared to the knowledge that you will reveal to us if we would just open ourselves to be used by you, God. Remind us, Father God, that everything we have is yours. Everything we have can be here one minute and gone the next. We are not to be so caught up with the things and the cares of life, but we are to be mindful of kingdom business, always doing kingdom business, always doing kingdom business. We don't know the day nor the hour, Lord, when you will call us home. And for those who don't know you, Father God, who may hear this message, Father God, I pray that you would reveal yourself to them, Lord God, and let them open up their minds to you, Father God, because no one comes to you unless you call them. Father God, I'm asking you to call the unsaved who will hear this message, Lord God. I'm asking that you would call them unto you. Seal them with your Holy Spirit. Jesus. Seal them with your Holy Spirit. Help them, Father, to find people that they can associate with who will teach them your ways. Surround them, Lord God, with wise counsel, Father God, in the natural, because everybody don't need no virtual church and no virtual covering, no virtual friendships. Thank God for those that follow me, but understand that sometimes some of you are in places where you need somebody you could touch, feel, and smell. I tell you it all the time. Direct them, Father God, to physical, tangible people that they can look eyeball to eyeball and hear a word from you, Father God. For those that are mature in Christ and who are looking for deeper soil in which to plant their seed, Father God, direct their path so that they will know where to plant their seed, where to give and distribute their harvest, Father God. Help them, Father God, to know where it is you would have them to be, spiritually and physically. Somebody's asking for direction, Father God. I pray that you would give them direction this night. Make it clear to them which way to go, Father God. Somebody's trying to make a decision, Father God. I know, Lord God, that you can answer any question. You can direct, Father God. I know because you do it for me. I'm always saying, Lord, what do I do in this situation? And you do it for me. So, Lord, I know if you do it for me, you'll do it for them. Give peace to those who are just tormented, Father God. I pray, Lord, that you would give them your supernatural peace at this moment, Father God. Give them joy, Lord God, for those who are full of sorrow, who just so sad in their spirit. Father, fill them with your love. Fill them with your joy. The joy of the Lord is our strength. Fill them with your joy, Father. For those who cannot hear you, Lord God, I ask you that you would supernaturally touch their spirit so that their spiritual ears can hear you throughout everything they do. No matter where they are able to hear you. Touch the mouths, Lord God, of those who are too silent, those who are too ashamed to speak. Thus saith the Lord, touch their mouths, Father God, so they can be the mouthpiece that you desire of them in this time, in this place, in their lives, wherever they are, Father God. You know the ones. Touch their mouths, Father God. The ones who are blind and can't see the things of the Spirit, even though you're showing them, they still can't see. Touch their eyes, Father God. Make it plain to them so that they can see the things that you're showing them. Give them the understanding so they'll understand what it is you're showing and telling them, Father God. Make everything crystal clear. No interpretation needed. Some people, oh, Jesus, some people, they can't understand the interpretation and the symbols. Lord God, I pray that you would give them straight visions and straight dreams. Thus they see it, thus it shall be. Let them know what they see is what it is. You don't want no confusion, Father God. No confusion in the lives of the people who are calling on you, who are depending on you. And as they grow in you, Father God, we know that you will change the way you communicate. But in this season, for those who need clear understanding, make it plain, Lord God. No symbols. No need to ask for revelation, interpretation, Father God. Speak directly to them like I know you can. For those who are willingly opening themselves to you, Father God, fill them with your spirit. Manifest in them, Holy Spirit, the gifts that you see fit for them to handle in this lifetime. Father God, I know that you are God who keeps his word. You are God who will make a way out of no way. I speak from experience, Father God. I let my light shine as an example on a hill so that those who are in the valley can find their way and know that if she made it, I can make it too. Amen. Yes, God. Hey, Shabbat. Hallelujah. 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 For those who are entangled and entrapped, oh, God, who went back after being delivered, I pray right now that you would be broken out of that trap, that bondage. Open your mouth and come against that covenant that you went back and reestablished. Come against it right now in the name of Jesus. Be free, be free, be free. In the name of Jesus, be free. You know who you are. You know who you are. You know who you are. You were delivered and you went back. God is saying, come out now, come out now. Open your mouth and declare, come out now. Break the covenant. Profess that you break the covenant. Call it out. That thing that you touched, call it out. Call it out. God is saying, speak it out. Nobody's listening, it's just you and God. I can't hear you, speak it out. God is saying, I'm willing to reestablish covenant with you. I had you cleaned up, but you went back. Father God is saying, come out now, come out now, come out now. Break the covenant. How do you break the covenant? Declare the thing that you touched, that you went back to, and break it. Jesus, Jesus, be free, be free. How do you be free? Someone asked me today, how do you be free? You break the covenant and you stay walking upright before God. You fast and you pray. That's how you break the covenant. That's how you stay free. Staying free is the hard part. Breaking the covenant is easy. When I tell people that, they be like, what? Breaking the covenant is easy. But staying free from covenant is hard. Why? Because you have to consciously be aware of your actions. You have to pray and ask God to what? Renew your mind. Because the mind is the battlefield. You got to put down your will and let the will of God rise up in you. Staying free is the challenge. Being free is easy. But it gets easier as you walk with God to stay free. Because once you get a taste of the goodness and the sweetness of Jesus, the Holy Spirit, and then staying in the presence of God and getting revelation daily, you realize I ain't going back there. I ain't touching that foolishness no more. Staying free becomes easier. Being free, breaking the covenant is easy. Staying free in the beginning is hard because it's what? It's work. Is mental 24/7 work. But you do it by what? Fasting and praying and getting into the word of God, surrounding yourself with like-minded people who are what? Determined to stay free. I said determined to stay free. You can't be with no jokers who one foot in the world and one foot in the church. Nah, that ain't gonna work. You need to be around folk who are sold out there. Let me help you. You need to be around some sold out people in order to stay free. And then you get so tied up in God and you understand like, oh, I'm eating from the land of milk and honey. This is so sweet to be in his presence. You one day wake up and you realize it's no longer a struggle to stay free. You just automatically remain free. And you have the spirit of discernment so strong in your life that you see the trap a mile away and you be looking at it like, not today. Yeah, nah, You could actually walk up on the thing and it don't move you. I'm talking what I know. I'm talking what I live. Amen. So that's how you be free and that's how you stay free. I can't give you no prayers to stay free without doing the work. I can give you the prayers, but you got to still do the work. You can't get an apple tree if you don't what? Dig a hole to put the seed in and water the seed. That's the work. You ain't eating my apples. I had to dig that hole. I had to get dirt up under my fingernails. I had to go out in that hot sun and I had to sweat. Giving an analogy here. Stay with me. You're not going to get it free. Salvation was not free. Christ died a gruesome death for us to have eternal life. So you think you're going to get delivered from these entrapments and covenants just by saying a 1-2-3 prayer and taking one fast? I think you done been, yeah, somebody done lied to you. There you go. Get you some sound doctrine. Get you some real understanding. Get you some good teaching. Ask God to connect you with people. The woman said today, she was dealing with spirit spouses. Don't know this lady from Adam. Don't recognize her name. Didn't expect nobody to know who I was in this group. She said, thank you for writing the book, Spirit Spouses. I'm like, what? She said she was dealing with that thing and God led her to Kevin and me. I'm like, whoa. You see, you just never know who knows about your kingdom work. She proved to me today, yeah, I better not wear a t-shirt saying I'm Zeta Grant. I will not wear a t-shirt and go out in public with that. I don't know who knows my work. And they really, truly don't ever need to know me. They need to know what? The work I'm doing for the kingdom. They need to know the work you're doing, Verna, for the kingdom. Candy's Jane. They need to know the work you're doing, Tarika, for the kingdom. They don't need to know us. They need to know the work we're doing for the kingdom. I thank y'all for staying with me. Yes, okay. I said I was going to be quick. I tried. But the Holy Spirit had stuff to do. And those of you who know, you know. Yeah. Turn off the TV. I said I had a word. This was inside me. God knows I had things to do. I got things to do. I'm going to go do it. But this was a word that was burning me from yesterday evening. And I just said, okay, Lord, I'm going to do it when I get home. Because somebody need to know, you know, you're not the only one who's waiting on your suddenly blessing. Some of y'all are waiting on your suddenly blessings, but I see it. I see it. It's coming. It's here. It's right around the corner. It could be as soon as you cut off this life. If you are living John 15 and 7, your suddenly blessing is now. And it don't have to be that big thing. It could be the small thing. You know, a lot of small, I'd rather have a bunch of small blessings than real big blessings. Because I need new blessings every day. Amen. I pray that this has helped somebody. I really do. I really, really do. I know it did because the Holy Spirit wouldn't have me come on here if it wasn't meant for somebody. Thank you, Deandra. Deandra said, much needed word. Okay, I know that my hour and a half was not just for me to blow steam and sweat up in this office and detox. Yes, Holy Spirit, I hear you. I hear you, Lord. I hear you. Somebody asked God a question and he said no. Somebody asked God a question and he said no. He said no. He said no. No, you asked him a question, and he said no. That's all I know. You asked me a question, he said no. Yeah, somebody want to relocate. He said no. He said no. That reminds me of seeing the, so focus on the tree, you can't see the forest. You know, I hear that a lot. I repeat that sometimes. I repeat that sometimes, and he said, you so focus on the tree, you can't see the forest. You want to relocate. God's saying no. Oh, God. You can't see what you got where you are because you're so focused on this one thing. God is saying, you're so focused on this one thing. He says, step back. The only way you see is a forest, you got to do what? You got to step back. You got to get far enough from the thing, from the object, so that you could get a panoramic view, if you will. You got to step back. He said, you're so focused on this thing, you can't see the forest. So the thing is a tree, but there are many trees in a forest. You can't see the beauty of where you are. You want to relocate. God's like, you will still have the tree if you relocate. Ooh, Jesus. Mm. You're still going to have the same problem if you relocate. God is saying no. You asked God if to relocate. He said no. He said no. Somebody's asking God, or you ask God about a job. got some job offers. You want to know which one to take. God say, take the one that will give you the most time. God say, take the job that will give you the most time. What do you mean? The job that will allow you to have free time. Ain't no use you working on a job and you don't have no free time. Because you need free time to do kingdom. You need free time to rejuvenate. You need free time to spend with God. You can't go on a job working because they're just paying you good, but they want you to work 60 hours a week. I'm talking about something I don't know. I've been there, done that. God is saying, you want to know which job offer to take? Take the one that will allow you to have the most time free for you to do kingdom with me. Ain't much difference in the pay. Titles are different. You're looking at prestige. God is saying, look at time. They could never pay you for time. That's why they pay you by the hour, especially in America. They pay you by the hour. They try to equate your time with the value of money. So they pay you X amount of dollars per hour. God is saying, the time you spend with me is priceless. Well, you take the job that will give you the most time. The job will give you the most time so you could spend priceless time with me. The job will still pay your needs. The job will still give you the money. The job will still pay your needs. But they can't pay you the way I'm paid. You can't give them all your time. Look, we only got 24 hours in a day, and you got to sleep at least six to eight. Some of us get five. But at least 8 hours. Then you got to get to a job. And if you got a family, you got to take care of them. When are you going to spend time with me, saying God? You lean into the wrong. Your eye too big, says God. Take the job that will give you the most time to spend with me. Because soon enough, when you start doing kingdom, now I'm talking about me. When I started to do real kingdom work, I'm praying every day, Lord, I'm ready to leave that job now, Lord. I'm ready for you to make a way so I can do kingdom 24/7. That is my prayer every day. Those who know me know that is my prayer every day. Lord, you done had several men and women of God speak over my life some things, and they prophesied some things. I'll be leaving, and you showed me in a dream I'm going to leave this job suddenly. Every day I go there expecting today to be the day I leave that job suddenly to do kingdom. Why? Because I took the job that gave me the most time with God. It paid my bills, made a good living for me and my family, but it gave me something no one could ever pay me for, time with God. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Okay, that's it, God. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Holy Spirit said he out. Holy Spirit got nothing else to give me to give you, so that means I'm gone. Oh, my goodness. An hour and 37 minutes. Well, I try, y'all. I really do try to come on here and get off, but the Holy Spirit have his way. And listen, the reason I don't hush him up, like they say, that's not the term they use. I forget what they use. Somebody type it in the comments. You know the old folks used to say, don't something the Holy Spirit, meaning don't shut him up. Let me see. Yeah. The reason I just let him flow is because I know when someone I follow come on live, I'm waiting for that word that's just for me. I know how important it is to hear the word of God. Esrene Smith, you're going to have to go listen to the replay, because if you jumped on this live while it's live, something I said during the live, you need to hear. So make sure you go and listen to the replay. Hey, listen, before I go, stop and share. Please share. This word is just not for you guys. This word for some other people too in your circle, okay? Please share this video. I want to see some shares on this video when I click off. If I don't see no shares, I'm going to call you out, because the Holy Spirit is saying, for those of you who caught this live, it wasn't a lot. There was 18 at one point. It's now 14 people. Share this video, because there's people in your circle who need to hear this message. I know what it is to want to hear a word from God, to need to hear a word from God. So when the Holy Spirit is moving, though I'd be trying to just jump on and jump off, I can't silence him, because there's something that he has to say that's not only for me, but it's for somebody else. So I'm telling you this for a reason. When God starts to use you, and he will, don't be in a rush to jump off. Don't be so quick. Sometimes you're gonna be praying for people and interceding with people and just answering questions, and you might be like, and I'm talking about stuff that I had to learn. You know, people ask me questions, I'll be like, you can't see that? You know, you, why are you asking me that question? You can't read your question out loud and see what I see. Holy Spirit had to remind me, they don't have the vision you have. They haven't been with me long enough to see what you see, Zita. So I'm saying to you, when the Holy Spirit is using you, remember, you made yourself a willing vessel to be used by God. When he's moving through you, don't be short with the people. Don't get mad. Don't get angry. You know, don't rush them along. It's going to take some people some time to get it, but they're going to get it. You know, it's like you in the math class. You know, you wasn't the best in the math class, and they had to show you how to do it over and over, and people were patient with you till you got it. And there's nothing like when you get it, when you understand, when that revelation kicks in and you be like, oh. You see, when you get revelation, that spurs the hunger for you to get more revelation. And the only way you're going to get more revelation is if you spend time with God. And that's the whole point. God wants everybody to what? Spend more time with him. So that they can what? Be filled with spiritual knowledge, with spiritual understanding to do what? Do spiritual warfare. Because what? We walk by faith and not by sight. We spiritually battle day in and day out, even while we wear this flesh suit. If we are what? Represented ambassadors of Christ. When Jesus walked the earth, he was doing spiritual warfare all the time. While he was walking in flesh, he was doing spiritual warfare. If you don't believe me, go read about Jesus and the time that he spent doing his ministry. He was constantly doing spiritual warfare. And I pray that you get the revelation of that. If you don't understand that, go read it and ask God to show you how Jesus was doing spiritual warfare. Him just walking on the earth was spiritual warfare. Why? Because the enemy knew who he was in the flesh. The enemy knew who God chose to be what? His representative, to be what? The blood sacrifice. The enemy recognized the spiritual power of Jesus as he walked the earth. Y'all have a good night. Please share the video. And I'm going to check to see how many people shared it. And I'm praying that you do, because the Holy Spirit is like, share this video, not for me. Share the video for the people who need this word in your circle. Amen. Good night. Have a blessed one. And I'm out.